Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This will be serial number 022 of the series Defeat the Shaitan. Innal hamdulillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayh. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu. ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله Inshallah, we will continue from where we left out in the previous session regarding the attack from the shaitan, attacking from the right. We had mentioned how people use the words of Allah and use that to win arguments and also to use it as a weapon. We must understand that Allah's words did not come for your personal arguments. They did not come so that you can make someone shut up. They didn't come to insult. They did not come to humiliate. They didn't come to suppress. Neither did they come to degrade. These people misrepresent the word of Allah. So by this what happens is making us think that we are actually extracting guidance, but all we are doing is pushing people away from Allah's guidance. When we use the word of Allah to humiliate someone, it results in the word of Allah causing them humiliation. Na'udhu billah. We became a reason for many families whose elders look religious, act religious, knowledgeable religiously, but their children are running away from religion because the word of Allah is misused in the home to yell at, to insult, and to humiliate the children. The children feel that their dignity is being taken away because of Islam. It is not the children's fault. See, our frustration is one thing. But our submission to Allah, our humility to Allah's guidance is something else. There is a way to communicate with your children when you are upset. Please don't use the deen for it. You don't own the deen. You don't use it to get away the way you want. The word of Allah did not come to establish your authority, your place, or to put somebody else in their place. Normally what we would say, if I am reciting the words of Allah, I should get a reward for this. See how the shaitan takes this good deed of recitation and attacks from the right. For example, when your boss gives you a set of jobs to do and he gives you the priorities in the way you have to do it. Like job 1 first, complete it, then go to job 2, complete that, go to the next job, and he has got a series of jobs to be completed by you. Now what you do is, instead of taking the priority that the boss has said, you take the one which is least priority and say that the job is done. So when your boss asks you, what is he going to do? What will you reply to him? You will say that you are so good at task number 5, the last one, so you did the best for that. And then you say, look how good I did this task number 5. So I need not do number 1. You don't decide that. Your boss makes the decision. He is the one paying you. He is the one who has hired you. He is the one who has the authority. Here the boss is Allah. He tells you the most important things in Islam. Like, here are the things you must do. Here are things you must stay away from. These are your obligations. You must accomplish these. And these are the things, no matter what, you must stay away from. Shaitan comes along and tells you, why don't you give a lot of charity? And since you're doing this a lot and you like doing it, you don't have to worry about the prayer. So when you ask yourself or somebody else asks you why you didn't pray, you justify by saying, yes, yes, I don't pray, but I give a lot of charity. But it doesn't substitute the priorities that Allah said. I don't have the right to set those priorities. Only Allah has the right. But then in your head, you convince yourself that you did something good. You gave charity, a task which you love doing. And then what happens? It comes to the mind, I can do whatever I want so that as long as I do good in Ramadan, then I have a 11-month vacation from whatever Allah asks me. Look at this scenario. Some people pray, they eat halal food, and once in a way they go to the restaurant along with their family to have a dinner. The head of the family is so very particular about that food being halal that he needs complete proof that it is halal before he orders any dish. He is so very tied up in making sure that what they are going to eat is halal. Yet at the same time, he hasn't given mahar to his wife as yet. He has denied inheritance to his sister. He is cheating people in business. He is not paying money back from people from whom he borrowed. In his head, this is important. This is my Islam. Other stuff is okay. This one act of mine will cover it. Allah will understand. Let me do just what I am comfortable with. And he feels that he is doing something great. The same about Hajj. Many people in their youth itself, when they have the strength, when they have the health and they can afford it, they put off the Hajj, saying, let me enjoy life a little. After I cross 60, then I will think of performing Hajj. Because when I do Hajj, the Prophet ﷺ has said that after Hajj, I'm like a newborn baby. So I'll be clean of all the things that I did during my life by performing my Hajj at that time, when I grow older. Can you imagine the mentality of this person? He is so sure that he is going to live till he performs the Hajj, when he should know that he may not live the next minute. How does he get his mind to come to this extent is difficult to understand. Now another thing is, you start defining for yourself what it means to be good. So you prepare a list of priorities in place of what Allah has given. You use your own feelings, your own impressions, your own opinions, and you put all these above what Allah revealed. Because you think that you are a good human being. You have a good heart. You have good intentions. So long as you mean well, that is what Allah wants. I know Allah says this, this and this. But you see, I'm actually a good person. I'm nice to people. I'm honest at work. I'm very courteous, etc. And then another way you console yourself is, at least I'm not like those people who pray, who have beards, wear hijabs, etc. I am not messed up like them. I have my own way of dealing with them. It's okay. Allah will understand. And further, I don't have to submit myself to Allah's revelation because there are bad examples out there. So I tell myself that Allah will understand and I will come up with my own lifestyle and tell myself that I am great. There's another scenario where there are people who want to find Islam, who want guidance, who want to get closer to Allah. And this they do by meeting certain people, either some people in the masjid or a friend's group or anyone who, to whom they have been introduced. And they get so carried away by this, they feel they are the only Muslims who are practicing Islam the best. What they know is correct. With this mentality, they keep moving around. They go to different places and they go to different masjids. But all masjids are not the same. All the Muslim guys are not the same. Because they may belong to different schools of thought. And unfortunately, like we see around us now, there are umpteen sects, and each sect having its own following, its own beliefs, etc. And some people, they have certain scholars whom they respect, or some people who go to an institution and follow a particular curriculum only. So what happens? This person is happy with these people because they found Allah through them. These people means the people whom they met first. But when they go to other masjids and meet other people, they find these people are different. The way they pray, the way they cover their heads, the way they grow their beards, etc. So in their mind, they may come to a conclusion that the group you found first is the right one. And to add to that, I feel bad for all these people here. So, what becomes your good deed? Your good deed is to go around warning everybody about the deviant who are going to hell. And try to convince them and try to join your group. You feel everybody else is misguided, everybody else is wrong. And then you go and tell the others, let me tell you why these people are terrible. And the main intention is getting them into one particular group that you started with. And you start looking into cults. He belongs to this, he belongs to this, she's from this group, that she's from that group. So ultimately what happens? In their mind, being Muslim is not enough. You should also belong to this sect, this jamaat, this so-and-so, this so-and-so, and ultimately this becomes your stand. Unfortunately, the feeling comes that it is not enough for you that Allah is the master. It is not enough for you that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the prophet. You want to make sure that they belong to the same group that you belong to. So the attitude taken is, I need to tell you how to fix yourself so you can join my group. This is the height of self-righteousness. No group of Muslims owns guidance. No masjid owns guidance. Nobody owns guidance. Guidance is only from Allah. It's with Him. So if you want to address them, there is a loving and humble way to express yourself to others, not degrading and humiliating Muslims just because of what they believe. How did the prophets handle such situations in their times? Another thing we have to be careful is when you're imparting knowledge, you attain a certain capability, a certain ability and certain amount of knowledge, which however much you may attain throughout your life is not even equal to a drop of water in the ocean. And instead of going ahead and spreading the knowledge for the sake of Allah, with the intention of pleasing Allah, what happens? Some people go around proud. I know this. Somehow I must tell others this thing. I know better than that person. I want to teach that person and tell him that he does not know this. I know this. The intention starts with wanting to please Allah, and slowly the shaitan takes you around and you start feeding your own ego. As a result of which, you think you know better. And then you start looking down upon people who don't have the knowledge that you have. Na'udhu billah. This is from the knowledge point of view, from the teacher's point of view. Even as a student, always remember and remind yourself that whatever knowledge you are gaining is to help you to get closer to Allah, full stop. And this is the end that you should have in mind, and your effort should totally be in this direction. So you have a teacher, you go to an institute, or you have personal teachers who try to help you out in these, and when the teacher starts appreciating your performance, they are doing it to encourage you, they are doing it to make you feel that you can do achieve better, you can achieve much more than what you have done now. But how does it turn around? You start feeling good. Wow, that teacher has praised me. That teacher has said that I know this very well. And instead of getting the knowledge for the sake of Allah, shaitan slowly starts feeding this into your ego and to your self-worth. Please understand, these are the subtle ways by which the shaitan can divert your mind and ultimately lead you to concentrate more on yourself rather than Allah, and in the end land up being ungrateful to Allah. Any number of good deeds that we may do for the sake of pleasing Allah, these good deeds, whatever we may do, how much ever we may do on our lives, these good deeds are not the ones that are going to take us to Jannah. Please keep that in mind. There was a man who was worshipping Allah for 83 years continuously without any stop. When he died and when he faced Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, "Do you want me to reward you for your good deeds?" No, I'm sorry. He said, "Come enter Jannah through my rahmah." He gets upset. What? I worshipped you for throughout my life, every minute of my life I was worshipping you. I've done so much good. I don't want to go by your rahmah. I want to go only by my own good deeds. I deserve to go to Jannah because I have done so many good deeds. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, enter the Jannah through my rahmah. He says, no. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the angel, okay, let's do one thing. Let me take all your good deeds and put it on one part of the scale. And one of the blessings that I have given you, let me put it onto the other part of the scale. So his eye is taken and put on the other part of the scale. This becomes heavy and his good deeds become nullified. So this is to teach us a lesson. Yes, please do your good deeds. Do all that you can to please Allah. Make every effort to get closer to Him. Increase your iman by continuing your good deeds. Doing good things, that righteous things that would please Allah. Don't stop doing that. Any amount the shaitan may disappoint you or tell you, no, what is the use, what is the use? Please don't fall a victim to him. Because Allah has deprived the shaitan of his rahmah. Allah is not depriving you of his rahmah. Take advantage of that one thing. May Allah guide us in every step of the way so that we are always grateful to him and we don't fall a victim to the shaitan in such a way, na'udhu billah, that we end up becoming ungrateful to him. Ameen. Ya Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma inna نستعين إنا نسألك إيمانا مستقيما وفضلا دائما ونزل الرحمة وعلما نافعا وأخلا كاملا وقلبا منورا وتوفيقا إحسانا وتوبة نسوها وصبرا جميلا وأجرا عظيما ولسانا ذاكرا वबदनन साबिरा वरिस्कों वासिया वसय्यम मशकूरा वजंबम मखफूरा वअमलम मकबूला वदुआम मुस्तजाबा برحم وجنت الفردوس نعيما برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين امين يا رب العالمين السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته